Okay, cool. No, but seriously, thanks very much everyone here for coming this evening to the second in our Standard Lives series of talks, This Future That Never Happened. And as I'm sure you well know, having bought tickets and arrived here this evening, tonight's session is really about, I suppose, planning, or at least the act of making plans, the projects and ideas that have never been built, and I suppose that pervasive idea of utopia that is so prevalent in so much of, I think, built and unbuilt work. So this evening, I won't go through what everyone's about to speak about. They'll do it better than I can. But this evening we have three speakers. Unfortunately, our fourth, Seamus Nolan, had to cancel at short notice due to family commitments. But he is allowed to have a family, so forgive him that. And but our three speakers that are here this evening include Brian Ward, architect and lecturer at DIT, Roisin Hennigan, who is an architect and director at Hennigan Peng Architects, and Carl Whitney, who is a writer and who you may mostly know from his recent book, Hidden City. And so I don't think there needs to be too much more said on that. We might as well kick things off and begin with Brian Ward.
So what I was going to do is talk about the town planning competition that happened in Dublin in 1914, and to explore the ramifications, to some extent, of that competition, or certainly to trace the ideas that were in that idea, or in that plan, or in that in the plans that came out of that competition, and see similar ideas being built in Dublin, and then at the end of the of my talk to start to focus on ideas that didn't have any, I suppose, long-term impact on the city. And I suppose I wanted to start with this slide in order to identify that most of the Dublin that we know today is a Dublin that was built while planning existed, while there was a planning department in the city council. In 1914, planning didn't really exist, certainly not in Dublin. It was quite a new idea. Of course, it can trace a longer history back to, for instance, the Wide Street Commissioners in Dublin and similar manifestations across the world. But the idea of a professional town planner and somebody who was linked and hired by a municipal council was a very new idea at the time. So the idea began to take hold, I suppose, in 1900, very much in reaction to the state of the cities across Europe, in particular, also America, in the late 19th century, the beginning of the 20th century. And of course, the planning that eventually comes to Ireland and to Dublin is a planning that is filtered through Britain, basically, which would have been one of the it would have been at the forefront of the creation of this new profession. But kind of bound up in that would have also been a lot of American ideas about the city beautiful that found their precedence in Haussmann's reordering of Paris in the 19th century. I suppose the city then that planning starts to have an impact on in Dublin and the city that was the basis of all of the plans that were drawn up during the town planning competition in 1914 was a city which was in a perilous state. It was a city, obviously, which had a great history, both in medieval history, but in particular, visitors were always struck by its Georgian legacy. But as a lot of you would know, the the way in which that city was being used at the in 1914 was that a lot of the rich who had who were able to afford to live in the townhouses built during the Georgian period had decamped out into the suburbs of Dublin, and the old townhouses had been tenementized across the 19th century, and Dublin being essentially a city without an industry at the time, it was a city of chronic poverty, I suppose that poverty and those living conditions were perhaps best captured in a series of photographs that are now called Darkest Dublin, of which this is one example. So because Dublin was in such a state, it was certainly to people in Ireland something of a surprise that the Town Planning Act that came in Britain in 1909 and didn't extend to Ireland. To some extent, that is understandable in that, or the way it was explained at the time, was that Ireland was seen as an agricultural nation, and that the forces that had made the planning necessary in Britain, the forces of industrialization that had drawn huge populations into the city centers of Britain, didn't manifest themselves in the same way in Ireland. Also, planning came out of a philanthropic tradition, whereby it finds its roots in industrial towns and in philanthropic endeavours such as Port Sunlight outside Liverpool. And Ireland didn't have a similar legacy. But as the Irish builder pointed out, Dublin of all cities, perhaps on these islands, needed. Planning perhaps a little bit more. And that became particularly evident during 1913, during the Dublin lockout, in which, as you all know, the labourers and the workers of the city united against the employers of the city. And there were mass demonstrations on the streets, and people were killed in the riots. And shortly after Bloody Sunday, some tenements on Church Street collapsed, essentially, killing seven people. And immediately there was a connection made between the riots and the arguments of the working class and the conditions in which they were living. So again, the need for town planning as a way of thinking rationally about how we might organise the city such that people lived in comfort in the city and such that the city became a healthier place and in terms of a middle class view of the city, that it become a place in which business might be done in an easier and more profitable manner. All of this starts to come into focus shortly after the Church Street disaster. And Dublin is fortunate at the time that the Lord Lieutenant's wife is a very dynamic lady called Lady Aberdeen, who has an interest in the living conditions of the poor in the city, and also an interest in this new discipline, this new profession of town planning that is emerging in Britain. So she organises, shortly by January 1914, she organises two events that really introduce planning to Dublin in a mass way, I suppose. She wants planning to become an idea that is being spoken about by the citizenry as a whole, and she sees it as part of Dublin getting ready to take its place as a capital city once again, because at that time home rule was imminent. So she invites a whole load of the emerging talents, I suppose, within town planning over to Dublin. The first person she invites over is Patrick Geddes, and he suggests to her that she organise a civic exhibition in 1914 that takes place in Linen Hall in Bolton Street over the summer of 1914. And as part of that then, she also organises a town planning competition that was to be adjudicated upon in September 1914, shortly after the civic exhibition. So while town planning was kind of high in everybody's agenda, these new visions of the city would be promulgated through the press, and she hoped then that the visions of the city that emerged from the competition would have some kind of impact in defining what planning is in Dublin, and then having an impact on the future layer of the city. And I suppose what is interesting about planning at this time is that nobody is quite sure what kind of discipline it will be. So there are divergent ideas about planning itself that get played out within this competition. And I suppose that's one of the things I want to trace here tonight, in order to make the point, I suppose, that the city that we now know as Dublin, particularly its suburbs, you know, are a manifestation of a very particular way of thinking about planning. But the future that never happened would have been a Dublin that saw a different kind of planning coming into being. Generally, in discussions about the town planning competition of 1914 in Dublin, Patrick Abercrombie, the winner of the competition, is the one kind of person who's talked about. What I want to do tonight is to show images from the other contestants as well, in order to understand to demonstrate the way in which there were different types of planning, kind of nascent at the time, but that never came into being. But to start with some of the Dublins that we do know, the first one being a Dublin that is zoned. And I suppose to introduce this section, just I thought it would be worthwhile introducing or reminding everybody that Dublin at this stage is a Dublin which is divided into various different townships, and each of those has its own particular politics. So the city itself is run by a nationalist corporation. Kilmainham is seen as a working class district, and Drumcondra would be seen as a kind of nationalist but middle class district. But the other townships are all seen as unionist, the politics of the way in which the city was being talked about is evident. You know, the politics is always rises to the top in any discourse about how the city might be thought of. At the time, and one of the things that planning was trying to do was to situate itself as an apolitical way of thinking about cities, and to think about cities purely in terms of in a technocratic way, in terms of that the city would be thought about in terms of efficiencies rather than in terms of what happened at the Battle of the Boyne, for instance. And a lot of the planners who come over to Dublin during this period can't kind of understand the complexities of the political situation. But people like the American F.A.C. Smith are able to do drawings of Dublin which are drawings of a Dublin in which those townships, that politics doesn't exist, and that there are no boundaries, and his vision huge drawings can be kind of given full vent, basically, and where he's a landscape designer, a landscape architect by profession, and Dublin starts to emerge in his drawings as a landscape laid out for the people of all politics, of all classes to some extent, and to enjoy in a similar manner. Patrick Abercrombie's drawings then focus a lot on thinking about Dublin and its traffic, and so again to think about Dublin as an efficient city in which products and people can travel through the city with ease and with efficiency, and at that stage he's drawing upon ideas emerging from planning in Paris, where traffic had emerged as a as an important idea. I suppose the traffic engineer doesn't exist at this moment, and so the planner is the person who brings that, you know, concerns about traffic and the flow of traffic into thinking about the organisation of the city. So this is the tram system then being mapped out by Abercrombie, and then in Abercrombie's drawings as well, and in a lot of the other drawings prepared by the entrance, we start to see Dublin being thought about not as a city divided up into various political strongholds, but instead a city which is zoned by use, so that you get working class housing districts, you get in industrial zones. And again, that notion of zoning that has become so familiar to us now, and that dictates so much of the way in which the city is talked about and thought about and developed, is a new idea which we can see emerging in these drawings. And then, of course, along with F.A.C. Smith, Abercrombie starts, and a lot of the other entrants start to imagine the city as a place of recreation as well. So the parks are mapped out, and various different recreational landscapes are drawn as part of the way in which people might enjoy the city. And all of this kind of thinking, very quickly, as you all know, I'd imagine, starts to dictate the way in which the city is planned. So by 1925, when the Dublin Civic Survey Committee published their series of maps of the city, it's being mapped in very similar ways to the way in which Abercrombie and the other entrants mapped the city. Okay, at the time as well, one of the striking things about planning is that it doesn't really distinguish itself from housing. Housing and planning are being talked about and thought about at the same time, because planning, as I was saying, was very much seen as dealing with the chaos of the 19th century industrialized city, and the deplorable conditions in which the working classes were expected to live. But most of the planners who entered the competition only deal with two types. They deal with flats or blocks of flats that can be placed into the inner city, and they deal with suburban housing. All of this is working class housing. And it's only the Irish entrants who look at the third element of housing that that Lady Abercrombie asked for, which was to look at how we might think about renovating or reorganizing the existing Georgian townhouse, such that people could live there in those houses in comfort. And so, what this section of the lecture does is concentrate on the former two, the blocks of flats and the suburban housing, because that's the housing that emerges most strongly from the competition entries. So in Abercrombie's plans, we see that the blocks of flats that working class flats, very small flats, and with outdoor balcony access. And again, they became very quickly familiar in Dublin, are still there, such as Mercer House, designed by H.T. O'Rourke shortly after, in about a decade after the competition. And then after that, of course, we get a long line of working class flats being inserted into the city centre. The other thing that we start to see emerging in the 1914 plans is the three great working class housing estates that are built in the 1920s and the 1930s. So they're all being, each of the, all of the planners who entered the competition identify Marino, Cabra and Crumlin as the districts in which working class housing, as in, you know, providing a house and a garden to working class families. So, you know, those districts are identified by everybody, and generally they're drawn in the formal manner in which they were eventually built. So again, to look at F.A.C. Smith's drawings, you get that way of thinking about the organisation of space, in a formal way, which derives from the City Beautiful movement in America, but which traces its back to you know, Haussmann's organisation of Paris, but draws also upon Olmsted's ideas about the organisation of landscape in America. So again, to look at Abercrombie's drawings, we get a formal arrangement of houses, and in Abercrombie's hands, quite large houses. But then in some of the Irish competitors, we start to see emerging the kind of house that we are familiar with in Marino, Crumlin, and Cabra. Small two rooms on the ground floor, and three rooms up above, and a kind of predilection towards the cul-de-sac, which again is a relatively new invention coming from Raymond Unwin in Britain, in Letchworth and Hampstead, and being brought across to Ireland at this stage, with the idea that through the creation of cul-de-sacs that you would create neighbourhoods, you know, that people would, the cul-de-sac would be part of a neighbourhood, but it's all part of kind of bringing people very deliberately into proximity with each other in order to create a community. And again, all of these ideas very quickly manifest themselves in around Dublin in places like Marino. Dublin isn't remarkable in this, in that these kind of planning ideas are finding themselves in the city centres of Britain as well at the same time, and in the suburbs of Britain too. The other thing that we start to see emerging is what I've called here ordered Dublin, but it could have been Haussmannized Dublin either. And again, a lot of the like all of the competitors indulge in kind of trying to imagine Dublin as this new capital city of a home rule nation. Most famously, probably in Abercrombie's drawings, and these are the ones that are published most frequently, where you start to see Dublin as a network of large formerly planned public buildings. In the centre of this one, we have a new railway station, which would act as a hub right in the centre of the city. But we also see a new cathedral at the top of Capel Street, and a new art gallery museum at the top of O'Connell Street. And then, kind of spinning off from all of those public buildings is a series of boulevards or avenues that would do Paris proud, basically. Abercrombie imagines Dublin as having a population of 5 million, which obviously has never really come to pass. But people like J.M. Bogle, so you know, an Irish competitor, also imagining the city in this manner. And to some extent, the fact that Dublin didn't have a Catholic cathedral was one thing which allowed this kind of expression of the city. All of the competitors started to place a large cathedral somewhere within the city, and then to organise big avenues up to it. So similarly then, Donnelly Moore, kind of grandiose cathedral with a large avenue leading up to it, and sections then that explore the way, you know, the proportions of those avenues. This again, this conception of Dublin, it didn't manifest itself as much, I suppose, as the zoned Dublin or the housed Dublin. But after the destruction of the Easter Rising in 1916, that was seen as an opportunity to begin to think about O'Connell Street, because O'Connell Street had to be rebuilt. Huge swathes of the area around O'Connell Street, as you all know, were destroyed through gunfire. And at this stage, the competition had fallen out of, I suppose, the consciousness of most people by 1916. In late 1914, Lady Aberdeen had, or Lord Aberdeen, sorry, had resigned his post as the Lord Lieutenant, and had moved on out of Dublin. And because of World War I, it hadn't been possible to gather all of the adjudicators in the city to look at the project. So it had kind of been forgotten to some extent. But after the Easter Rising, the adjudicators were the adjudicators who could gather in Dublin were gathered in Dublin, and then the drawings were sent to John Nolan, who was in Boston, and they all agreed on winners. That was all done in order that the competition might have a legacy in the way in which the city was thought about as it was rebuilt after the destruction of the Rising. So, for instance, and then there had to be a huge, because at that stage there still wasn't any planning laws in Ireland. They had to be basically written, ad hoc after the Easter Rising, and then agreed with the property owners on O'Connell Street. But what came out of that whole process was that the lower image is O'Connell Street prior to the Easter Rising, and then the O'Connell Street that was built. And I suppose the evident thing is the aligned parapet. So there was, this was seen as a way to start to bring planning to Dublin. It was seen as an opportunity, and I suppose some of those ideas that we see in Abercrombie's drawings start to manifest themselves in that stretch of O'Connell Street. But the third way of thinking about housing as something which housing that could occur within the existing townhouses of George and Dublin never really had a huge legacy on the city. We'll look at a little example in a moment, but it's the one which kind of fell through the gaps, really. It was only tackled by Irish competitors in the competition. Most sensitively, perhaps, by Cape Parry and Ross, who start off their plan for the city by a very careful analysis of the slums of Dublin, drawing a map which the adjudicators commend. It's the thing that they most commend about Cape Parry and Ross's entry into the competition. And then they begin to propose ways in which two townhouses could be paired together, removing one of the staircases in order to make three apartments that could act off a common stair hall, and then building a toilet block to the back of that stair hall, such that each family would get a toilet, but it would be accessed from the landing of the of the stairs. Donnelly Moore explore a similar idea, but taking the stairs out and reorganising it such that the toilets aren't accessed off a half landing, but off the landing that also serves two apartments, one of which is quite big. I suppose this is a type of planning that never really manifested itself. It's a planning that requires an intimate knowledge of the types, the housing types, that existed in a city, and therefore it's a planning that is local in a way that planning wasn't really being thought of at the time. Planning was being imagined as a universal, as something which could be universally applied. It's also a planning which requires thinking at a scale that isn't normally associated with planning. So you know, not at the at the large scales, but you know, at the scale of 1:50 or even even finer. Ellen Rowley has discovered that some of this thinking did actually manifest itself in some housing or some kind of reconditioned tenements built just off O'Connell Street, as it happens on Sean McDermott Street, but no longer existent. They were demolished in the 80s, but they involved. They're quite different to Kay Parry and Ross's scheme in that it involved putting a light well down through the centre of the of each of the houses. But nonetheless, it came from a similar way of thinking about planning and a planning that could respond to the housing types of a particular city. The last Dublin then that I wanted to look at was one that definitely didn't kind of manifest itself in the planning of Dublin. And it was a Dublin which Siar Ashby, one of the competitors who was a romantic socialist or an utopian socialist who comes to the city. And he had shortly before that been in Messina and also San Francisco, two cities that had been destroyed by earthquakes. And the Dublin that he saw reminded him of those cities in that it it was a city which he thought had been destroyed. And I suppose that has to be understood in the context of a city in which quite a few of the tenements had either fallen down or had been demolished by the city council as part of a clearance. And what he had observed in San Francisco in particular, but also Messina, was that temporary and prefabricated housing had been provided on the fringes of the city. And he recommended that a similar approach be taken in Dublin. And he in particular, he was interested in hot pickers' houses that were being mass-produced in Liverpool at the time. And he suggested that they be built on the fringes of the city such that the tenements could be emptied, people could live in these houses. And his hope was, his thinking about the centre of the city, or one of his thoughts about the centre of the city was that university settlements would be set up, whereby the working classes would be taught crafts and the ability to place those crafts within kind of greater ideas about civilization. With the idea being that in tandem with this, with the education they would get in these university settlements, plus with the kind of skills that they would learn while gardening out in the suburbs, in the ground around their temporary housing, that they would be reattached to the land and to craft in the way that they're. Ancestors would have been, before they came from rural Ireland into the city. So what he imagined then was a citizenry living in Dublin that knew about making, basically, and that then would, over the 25 years that was the lifespan of those of that temporary housing, that they would begin to think about, to think and to discuss amongst themselves what kind of city they wanted, and then they, because of their newfound ability to build and to make, they would start then to build that city themselves. So slightly akin, perhaps, to what happened on the outskirts of Vienna after World War I, the city the Austria came out in the wrong end of that particular war. The city was downgraded and was no longer the capital city of an empire. A lot of civil servants found themselves having to move out to the fringes of the city and to build their own housing. And out of that, it was hoped that at the time by architects such as Loos and all the rest, that a new kind of way of thinking about the city might emerge. It never quite happened, but it certainly ties in with the way in which Ashby was thinking about the citizenry of Dublin. And I suppose what's interesting about that is the very different and the very kind of engaged citizenry it imagines for planning. It imagines a much more kind of democratic, perhaps, planning that we have ended up with in Dublin. And it's hard to know what kind of city would have emerged if that kind of vision of planning had of come to pass. But it would have been quite a different city, one would imagine, and certainly a city with which we would enjoy quite a different relationship than we do today.
Okay. Thank you very much, Brian. Always fascinating to see so many versions of a unbuilt Dublin, and all from just one period. It's funny to think just how many more unbuilt projects there must be out there in the last 100 years alone. Also, I love those Georgian projects. Never knew they existed. Anyway, our next speaker is Roisin Hennigan.
Thank you. Thank you for asking me. I think a lot of architects have a whole drawer full, or a virtual drawer full now, of futures that never happened. And these are two projections, or two that we did. They occurred at two different times, 2006 and 2009. And in both cases, they were kind of thinking about how, maybe not Dublin, but how the planning of the city and parts of Ireland could develop. So the first one was. And like architects, we always do them in response to a bit of a brief. So the first one was for the Venice Biennale in 2006. We were invited by FKL as part of a group of nine people. And their thesis was that, the classic, or the best practice planning response to the problems of development are always like that. You have to densify the city, that densifying the core is essential. But their thesis was that in Ireland, so many people want the house with the garden, that is never going to fully work if we don't take on the problem of this kind of house and garden relationship, which is kind of a suburban. So what they proposed was that we needed to consider what they called super rural, and that we needed to kind of project forward to 2030 how Ireland could develop. So that's what they asked us to do. And when we started thinking about it, we started to think about, I suppose, Dublin in relationship to Ireland. So if you think about Dublin, it has about 40% of the population of Ireland. It generates close to 50% of the GDP, and it generates 55% of the income tax take of Ireland. So it's a real colossus, if you like, in relationship to the rest of the country, and everybody wants to get to the centre, which kind of starts to create a problem because everything is driving in towards that centre. And then in parallel, we were thinking about Ireland, population of 4.6 million, more or less. It's an island economy, very dependent on trade, so very dependent on connections to the outside world. Therefore, air travel is very important. So if you look at Dublin Airport in 2006, it had 21 million passenger journeys. That's for a country as a whole of about 4.6 million. But then when you look a bit more at those 21 million passenger numbers, half of those are to the UK, and of those journeys to the UK, half are to London, to the London area. And looking at that London-Dublin route, it has it's the busiest air route in Dublin, or sorry, in Europe, and it's one of the busiest in the world. So if you think about the importance of that air travel and connectivity, and then you start to think going forward to 2030, air travel, and especially these short hop journeys, are a real problem for carbon emissions. So we were thinking, okay, this is a bit of an existential problem. You know, we have an island here that's very dependent on air travel, and then you have the whole problem of carbon emissions. So we started to think about the land, or not the land route, but how, what's the route to London? It's about 570 kilometres. And a high-speed train will travel at about 250 kilometres. So our proposal was to build a train route from Dublin to London. It would go along the east coast. It would connect over at Fishguard, to Rosslare to Fishguard, and then continue on to London. And then, of course, you'd have the connection to the rest of Europe. So there are technical problems. It's an 80-kilometre stretch there, so it would be one of the longest bridges in the world. It would be the longest bridge, I think, in the world. But more than the length, it is, the Irish Sea is very deep. It's about 100 metres deep, and a high-speed train needs stable foundations. So we would need to found it. So we were thinking that we could use oil rig technology, but it would be very, very expensive. But in the meantime, we spent, of course, a lot of money. But what that would do then is, rather than Dublin now being completely the focus of everything in the country, it would start to spread that development along the coast, because London now is also a very big attractor. So we thought that instead of Dublin, everything kind of focusing into the centre, we'd start to stretch that development along the coast, along a train route. So we would start to kind of stretch out that relationship that everybody wants, the house and garden. So we'd now stretch it out along the coast, but we'd have it connected back into a train line. And we'd also kind of, if you like, curtail some of that development. So rather than stretching it kind of all the way out to Athlone, it would now start to be in a defined route, and some of the rest of the country would be left a little more unspoilt. And that was an image of that. So I suppose, in a way, with that proposal, there was a real faith in big infrastructure moves, massive government involvement to try to solve a problem. And then in 2009, Michelle came back to us all again, and of course in 2008 there was a crash, and she said, okay, you know, she thought that architects could perhaps have a role to play in imagining what could happen. So she asked us all again to think about this and to come up with some ideas. And she, there was a conference, there was an exhibition and an evening event around it. What we decided to do was, rather than having, if you like, the big move that we had for 2006, we thought we needed to approach it a different way. So we asked everybody in the office, took a half day to think about what would you do. And then another half day where we pinned everything up on the wall, we invited Brian Swan, who's assistant city architect with Dublin City Council, to come in, and we did a pin-up and talked about it. And essentially the responses kind of organized themselves, I think, into three categories. There was short-term solutions, medium, and long-term. And so time was introduced as a factor, which was something we hadn't really thought about before. And then all of this was presented at this drawing, which kind of went forward to 2013. So the short-term solutions were really about reusing properties, and they were really dealing with the fact that in 2008 there was a lot of unfinished developments, that were never taken over. So there was institutionalized squatting in exchange for low rents. People could either take over properties commercially or residentially, and the benefit of that, of course, would be that you wouldn't have vacant streets, you wouldn't have vacant properties. That would help to, I suppose, mitigate the effects on other properties and streets. And actually, that has occurred. Then looking outside of Dublin, there was a lot of development, say, alongside the Shannon, trying to reverse that. A lot of those empty apartments, turning them over to put them in service to the river, where they could start to create landing points for houseboats along the river. trying to suggest that some of those empty sites could maybe be used for farming, and some of the money goes back into the exchequer. And the suburban farmer, where empty lots are used either for market gardens, or people pay again a nominal rent and use them to grow their own crops. And actually, that's something that has been done. This is something we came across, Carnegie Mellon paper, which looked at greening vacant lots in Pittsburgh. And that was quite successful. The paper said that of every $1 that was invested, there was a $2 return to the city. So in Pittsburgh, Baltimore, Cleveland, some of those American cities where there has been a lot of emptying out of the core of the city, undertook some work on this. So that was kind of short term. So short term was really all about trying to ameliorate the situation. Medium term started to look a bit more at some of the values that we were placing on things. So here one of the suggestions was that rather than actually building out all of the projects, that maybe some of the ruins should be left, and they could become part of that whole Irish mythology of the misty ruins. But also, I suppose, maybe a little bit of an art project to ourselves, that not to forget what happened, because it's so easy to forget. This is a thought about reciprocal colonization, that maybe we could do an exchange. So at the time, we probably wouldn't have got much land elsewhere, but we could, we say, give land over to other countries, that they could develop something on the various sites. Selective demolition, I think this was a really serious proposition. It's already happened in Ireland with Ballymun. But should all of the developments be finished out? Should some of them be demolished? And even of those that are finished, especially you can think of in scenic areas, do you really, should they really have existed in the first place? So, and then everyone's a developer of some of the developments that weren't finished. Could they be handed over to housing associations so that people start to have a voice in how they get developed out? So rather than everything coming top down with the developer, that some of it could go bottom up. And then long term, and what this was really more about was trying to think about how could this maybe not happen again, or what lessons have we learned? So one thought was that, of course, there is, I don't know how much land now there is, but there was a huge amount of land that NAMA had at the time. So could some of this land be, say, given to centres of academic excellence, which could then have a base in Ireland, with strong links obviously to the UK and to the US, English speaking, that there might be a reciprocal relationship again that could benefit the country here. This is more a mindset, but that a house needed, there needed to be a switch in thought from thinking of it as a commodity to it as a home, so that when people are starting to think about where they might buy, or where, that it's, is it a place to live rather than a place for investment. And then we also thought that rates, some form of rates property tax needs to get reintroduced, because the local authorities need a stable income stream in order to allow them to, I suppose, plan for the future, but also not to be so dependent on development levies, because there has to have been, you know, a case where a lot of these developments occurred, or there was pressure to occur because of the need for, or the, I suppose, the promise of what the development levies could allow the local authority to do. And finally, we started to think, okay, you know, there was so much focus of it, of everything that went wrong, but there were some good things that happened during the boom, and you know, what could we learn from the things that were, or the projects that were well done, and what we, I think, universally thought, at least within our office, was the real benefits were in the infrastructure investment in the Lewis, in the various public space improvements, in train upgrades, in cycle lanes and bus lanes, and we liked some of the roads. and that is what brought us to now. So, thank you.
Publicly admitting to inventing the property tax. And seeing as that went through, I'm keeping my fingers crossed on that rail link to London. That has to be the next stop. And up next is our final speaker of the evening, Carl Whitney.
Obviously, this is a single slide that you'll see with a hold my talk, but obviously in this case my emphasis is very much on design. You know, I've used the Comic Sans font for Start Again, you know, nice friendly font, I think. What I'm going to be talking about is a chapter, what became a chapter of my book, called The Bus Game. I was thinking about why I actually did what I did, and what I did I'll tell you about in a second. And in the context of kind of planning and utopian planning. So when you write about a city, your imagination is constantly oscillating between the present, what you see in the here and now, the past, and what may or may not happen in the future. One pretty interesting way of examining the past and comparing it to the present is to look at the possible futures that were imagined in the past. Streets not built, buildings never constructed, ideas rejected. They're a utopian stick with which to beat the imperfect present. In 2013, when I was writing a chapter about transport in Dublin for my book, major public transport projects were being shelved. Metro North, Metro West, Dart Underground. It felt like I was witnessing the kind of postponed or cancelled projects that might haunt the city in the future, in the same way that the removal of Dublin's old tram system is a focus of a certain kind of longing. But I also realised that the danger in writing about those projects, so Metro North, Metro West, or Dart Underground, in conjuring a premature nostalgia for wrong turns taken in the recent past, was to be sucked into fairly banal current affairs debates about still-warm controversies. I didn't want to do that. So I decided that if I wanted to imagine a utopian future for Dublin transport, I would have to do it myself, and on a severely limited budget. I fixed my attention on Dublin Buses Travel 90 ticket. I'm going to read briefly from the chapter. I used to make the journey from my parents' house to university, an awkward trans-suburban trip that could not be comfortably completed without changing buses once, using a Travel 90 10 journey ticket. The small print on the back of the Travel 90 points out that the final journey must start within 90 minutes of boarding the first bus. Because I'd only ever used a ticket for my commute, two buses in the morning and two in the evening, I hadn't really considered the broader possibilities of the Travel 90 until one Sunday afternoon a few years ago, when I needed to pick up a couple of books I had left in my office at University College Dublin. I was travelling from my girlfriend's house, and because it was Sunday and the traffic was quiet, I was able to reach the campus quickly, in just over half an hour. Once I'd collected the books, I returned to the bus stop, caught a bus to the city centre, and then another south to my parents' house. I didn't have to wait long at any of the stops, there wasn't much traffic, and I got on the last bus within 90 minutes of boarding the first. So I'd taken four buses for around the cost of a single trip. Sometimes it feels as though the city and its infrastructure are designed to drag you down. Sluggish buses, trams and trains, heavy and aggressive traffic on the roads, dawdling pedestrians who get in your way when you're in a rush. But once in a while things go right, the pavement opens up in front of you, all the lights seem to turn green, or your train pulls in on time. That Sunday journey across the city to my office got me wondering if it was possible to turn bus travel into a game, a means of exploring the city in a different way. To be fun, the game needs rules, limitations, and here was where the Travel 90 came in. How many buses, I wondered, could you travel on within the ticket's 90-minute window? And how far could you go? I took a small piece of paper, quite big in this because I've blown it up, but small enough when folded to fit into my wallet, and wrote out a list of rules. Firstly, I would choose a starting point, a bus stop somewhere in the city. I'd get the next bus that came along, validate the Travel 90 ticket, and start a stopwatch. I'd get off the bus 10 minutes after I'd boarded, flip a coin, then catch the next bus in the same direction, or in the opposite direction, depending on whether the coin came up heads or tails. After 90 minutes, the journey would be over. If I were on a bus, I would get off at the next stop. I liked the idea of travelling across a city in a way that wasn't dictated by necessity, and I liked the idea of using public transport to bring me to an unpredictable destination. And in this, I was drawing on certain, well, the Situationist derive. So in the 1950s, the Situationist International, who were called the Letterist International, confusingly then, kind of went on crawls across the city of Paris. They ended up in pubs at 2 a.m. Some of these derives, as they called them, lasted for a couple of days. And all we have as proof for these sort of exercises is an account, a short account that was published in their journal. But anyway, so drawing on this, drawing on the Situationist derive, and also drawing on the avant-garde group Ulipo, who saw constraint, the literary uses of constraint they were very preoccupied with. So I suppose the greatest example is Georges Perec's novel that doesn't use the letter E at all. So words without the letter E. Basically it was decide not to do something and follow it through. Based on that, I decided to elaborate a set of rules. The Travel 90 was a 10-journey ticket introduced in 2003 by Dublin Bus. It's kind of become a historical artifact now, I'm sad to say, because I think in April or May this year they discontinued it. It might still be available in some shops that have a supply, so if you want to try the bus game, go ahead. For my first trip, I wanted to begin in the centre of things. I chose O'Connell Street. The question of which side of O'Connell Street to stand on was resolved by a flip of a coin as I crossed the west side of O'Connell Bridge. The coin came up heads, so I remained on the west side, stopping at the first bus stop I came to outside Easton's. There I would wait for the next bus that came along heading north. I waited 10 minutes and a number 123 arrived, a yellow and blue livery double-decker. The 123 runs from Walkinstown, a suburb southwest of the city, to Marina, northeast of the centre. I'd never been on this route before. I validated my ticket, started my stopwatch, and climbed the stairs to the upper deck. It was around midday and the traffic was light as the bus took a right from O'Connell Street onto Cahill-Brew Street, then, in short order, a left and a right. The route felt knotted and slow, and as the bus idled at the junction of Parnell Street and Gardner Street, waiting for the light to turn, I wondered if I'd make it out of the city centre before I had to ring the bell and get off. I looked at my watch, 5 minutes to go. As I sat there and my anxiety grew, I wondered why I was so concerned with the bus's progress. After all, I had nowhere in particular to go and 90 minutes to get there. Nevertheless, until the bus finally accelerated away from the inner city, I was edgy. Instead of allowing me to break away from the more mundane aspects of public transport, it seemed the rules of this game intensified the vexation of bus travel. By the time the bus had travelled up the narrow red brick thoroughfare of Phillipsburg Avenue in Marina, my 10 minutes had run out. I got off at the next stop, flipped the coin, it came up tails across the road, but I could see no stop on the opposite side. I walked north, following the route of the bus I'd alighted from, but there was no sign of any stops, which led me to think that the 123 took a different route on its inbound leg. A smartphone would have clarified matters at this point, but I didn't have one. I reckoned that if I could trace the outbound route, I'd eventually come across an inbound bus stop on the opposite side of the road. I continued to walk north up Phillipsburg Avenue, past a row of shops and some old two-story houses. At the intersection with Griffith Avenue, I crossed to the only bus stop I could see, next to the entrance to the Marino Institute of Education. I fished my cheap mobile phone from my satchel and texted the number of the stop to Dublin Buses Bus Text Service, which sent me details of the next three buses due to arrive there. All were 123s heading for Marina. Looking eastwards along Griffith Avenue, I saw 100 or so metres away on the other side of the road a stop at which a handful of people had gathered. Although the group was small, it illustrated in microcosm Dubliners' attitude to queuing for the bus. They don't do it. Instead, oddly amorphous gatherings of anything from three people to, at busier city centre bus stops, several dozen, spread themselves across the pavement near the stop. When the bus approaches, there is some speculative manoeuvring as the more desperate or clued-in travellers attempt to judge where it will stop. Those who judge correctly are rewarded with being among the first few on the bus, while the rest wait their turn in the scrum on the pavement, shuffling slowly towards the doors. Needless to say, an orderly queue would speed up the whole process and be fairer, but it would be contrary to the ways of Dublin, and I can't help but feel it would detract from the festive anarchy you invariably encounter at the city's bus stops. I did this bus game a few times, and there are some accounts, a select few accounts in the book. But basically, one of the problems I encountered, well, one of the many problems I encountered with the bus game was, I assumed that when you toss a coin, there'll be a balance between, I don't know what the statistics on this are, but there'll be a balance between heads and tails. On one particular journey, I threw tails five times in a row, which meant if I'd gone 10 minutes in one direction, I'd go 10 minutes back. So I went up and down Dame Street four times. So really, after a few tries on a 10-minute journey this way and a 10-minute journey that way, if you can imagine, 10 minutes in Dublin on a bus don't get you very far. So I decided to up the time limit to 20 minutes. And if I can find it, I'll briefly read it to you. For my second attempt at the bus game, I decided to tweak the rules. Each leg of the journey would last 20 minutes rather than 10. I thought this might bring me further from the city centre. I also wanted to minimise the chances of getting locked into a single route, and I was particularly keen to avoid the Ballyboff Merino Malahide Road corridor. So around 11 a.m, a few days after my trip, I walked to a bus stop on College Green, which has perhaps the densest concentration of bus routes south of the Liffey, I think. From here, buses could take me west or southwest. The first to arrive was number 40, going in the direction of Liffey Valley Shopping Centre. I boarded and sat downstairs near the back. On Thomas Street, where people browsed at stalls set up along the pavement, an elderly man got on the bus and sat next to me. He held a plastic bag in his hand that smelled of fresh meat. A little while later, a woman with a small dog, a King Charles Spaniel, boarded and stood near the front doors of the bus. The dog doesn't eat the meat, I have to dissuade you of that. Sadly, would have been great copy. A King Charles Spaniel boarded and stood near the front doors of the bus, discussing the dog with a man sitting nearby. "He's like a child," she said. After 20 minutes, we were in Inchy Court, where I flipped the coin. Needless to say, it came up tails and crossed the road to the opposite stop in front of a red brick terrace just outside Richmond Park football ground. The bus that brought me back to the city centre was a 13, a different route from the one that brought me to Inchy Court, although it followed the same streets back to the centre of the city. After 20 minutes, I disembarked in O'Connell Street. A horse and cart full of bric-a-brac, rusty sewing machines, park benches, made its way up the street as cars whizzed past it, advertising a well-known tourist pub situated in the Dublin mountains. I flipped a coin, turned up tails yet again, and crossed the wide thoroughfare to the bus stop outside the Savoy Cinema. It was now lunchtime, and Dublin's traffic was congealing. Stern choral music emerged from a small religious shop next to the cinema, one which regularly posted graphic anti-abortion material on its front window. It's gone now, sadly. After a few minutes, a number 9 bus came along, and I jumped on. It sat in traffic on O'Connell Street. There's a theme developing here. It sat in traffic on O'Connell Street for the next 10 minutes. By the time it squeezed down Dame Street and turned south, my 20 minutes were nearly up. I got as far as South Circular Road before ringing the bell. So that's O'Connell Street to South Circular Road in 20 minutes. I flipped the coin tails and got the next number 9 back into town, where on 90 minutes I disembarked at a stop almost directly across from where I had begun my journey. My tweaks to the game, starting from a different place, lengthening the time limit before I disembarked each bus, had not altered the basic dynamic. I conceived the game as something that would bring an element of play into using Dublin buses, but instead of the lightness and exhilaration I had hoped for, I was feeling the extreme frustration familiar to the demoralised commuter. I had to remind myself that I didn't have to get anywhere, that I had undertaken this game of my own free will, and that I could stop at any time. But I didn't want to stop, not yet. I would try again. Perhaps the game was not intrinsically misdesigned. Perhaps I'd just been unlucky with the coin flips. So I end up just getting a bus in a single direction because I didn't know what else to do with the game, which is basically just travelling on a bus. So I did a few more Travel 90 trips, and what I found was this. I wasn't really, I kind of conceived of it. You know, I'd get on a bus and I'd get multiple buses and I'd find this new place in Dublin that I've never seen before. And you do, you find different suburban streets. But you know, you probably have been there before. So I wasn't really finding new places in the city, but I was forced to take new trajectories to improvise around the rules I'd drawn up in order to deal with the shortcomings of the system I'd imposed. Perhaps I'd initially concentrated a little too much on the notion of finding a place I hadn't been before. Instead, the process forced me to modify my behaviour, the way I moved around the city. That inevitably meant that I experienced the city in a different way. Intense frustration was definitely one of the ways I experienced the city. The classic transportation necessity of getting somewhere was subordinate to the mission I had set myself, although I had to remind myself, and the disjunction between these two systems allowed me to take a different perspective towards the city, one I channeled into the book chapter. When we talk about utopian projects, unbuilt or imperfectly realised, as they always must be, we're invariably drawn towards their traces, their visualisation in blueprints, drawings and textual descriptions. So I suppose the meagre traces of my project are in my book and in this talk. The bus game was my low-budget effort to briefly actualise my own personal hour-and-a-half-long utopia using Dublin's imperfect transport system. Or was it? I was thinking about this earlier today as I passed through Dublin Airport, as I was channeled through the queuing system towards passport control. I thought about the bus game again. Maybe perfecting the system was exactly what I didn't want to happen. Perhaps instead I was looking for that slight shift in perspective I mentioned, but also imperfection, failure. I wanted something to go wrong, because when things go wrong, that's when narrative emerges. Someone drives to work every day at the same time, day in, day out, except this one day when... Looking back at my book, there are recurring motifs of incompletion and systems failure. Houses that I think are James Joyce's but aren't, sewage pipes getting blocked, traffic snarling up. And I like to think these motifs aren't just products of my own shortcomings, but instead reflect the kind of failures that happen on a larger level in the city on a day-to-day basis. Ultimately, the bus game didn't work, but as we're always being told, as we're always telling ourselves, utopias never do. Thanks very much.
Great, many thanks for that, Carl. And fascinating game that none of us will ever play. For your sake, I hope it didn't. Now I might just ask four or three speakers if they want to just join us just at the panel seating over to the side there. And if anyone has any questions, now's the time to be pondering them. If I kind of maybe just ask both Carl and Brian, because Carl, your adventure is kind of semi-explore some of Brian's built and unbuilt worlds of like Merino and Crumlin and these kind of areas and which aren't successfully traversed by bus. I suppose maybe start with Brian. that was probably something that was, you talked about transport schemes and some of those early plans. I mean, from your kind of knowledge of it, would you say that maybe it would have allowed for that randomness to occur?
No, I think the kind of people that they were imagining on those routes that they were drawing across the plan were people who were going places. They weren't trying to kind of have fun on necessarily on that infrastructure. But I was reminded of C.R. Ashby, actually, the romantic socialist who, to some extent, found himself in planning rather than, it seemed to be the thing he should do rather than necessarily, he wasn't a good fit for a planner, basically. And he has left good records of his time in Dublin, where it was all of that kind of side of Dublin which he liked, the way in which the city didn't work, the kind of chat you'd have with a jarvey driver, as it was at the time, as you were, stuck in traffic for a long time. The way, all of that kind of stuff. And he, I suppose, Dublin being the Dublin of the time and the Celtic Renaissance happening at the same time, he kind of romanticized that. He enjoyed the Celtic twilight, as he described it. So, but he would have seen that then as I suppose running counter to what planning was all about. So he was kind of he thought there was a certain justice in the fact that really very little of the ideas that you see in Patrick Abercrombie's drawings ever got built, because he thought Dublin wasn't really that kind of city that you'd come up with a plan and then put it into action.
And Carl, do you lament the loss of those utopias?
I think they're interesting, I think utopia, the more I think about utopia, the more I think of it as this comparative, this kind of, here's what happened and here's what could have happened. So you're constantly comparing, and through the comparison between the plans that you showed and what actually happened subsequently, you come into some sort of more playful understanding of the process, I think, of constructing a city, the choices not taken, and the possibilities in planning, in a way, in imagining what the future might look like. Definitely, I think that one of the Abercrombie's plans with the sort of the street through kind of beside Christchurch, more or less, this gigantic boulevard. It was related to kind of slum clearance as well.
Yeah.
So it was literally like very similar to Usman and his plans for Paris, the way he just clear a neighborhood.
Yeah.
And Robert Moses later, in New York. I think that I had never seen the utopian, the guy that you showed in his sort of conception of the city. And it's interesting, to his conception of the city is not purely visual in the way that the others are.
No.
Because he's not saying this is what it'll look like.
Yeah.
He says we'll hand it over to people.
Yeah. He does indulge in the, like, there's, he does his big avenues and all the rest as well. Yeah. They're never quite as straight as everybody else's. They kind of go off, and you're not sure whether that's just because he's drawing badly or whether it is part of the way he
that's
thinks.
That's a human element.
Yeah, no, exactly. Yeah, his that I think that's key to it. Like at the end, that notion for me was the most interesting one that comes out of his plan, the idea that you just kind of educate people and then see what they might come up with themselves, and that you educate them in making rather than thinking or planning, so that they would just go and do it, and see.
What interested me as well about his ideas is that it's about educating people and putting them more in touch with nature.
Mm.
I mean, ostensibly that's what Crumlin has built and Rialto has built were meant to do.
Yeah.
This kind of ruralization of the urban peasantry.
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah.
But he had thought it through. It wasn't just a, here's a garden, don't go to a pub, sort of, conception.
Yeah. It is, but it cut through both his notion of, you know, everybody learning to garden again and all of that kind of stuff, and Drummond Marino Cabra is this notion that Dublin isn't a proper city, you know, that yeah. there aren't actually urban dwellers there who, you know, with ancestors that stretch back for hundreds of years that have lived in the city, you know, that everybody sees it as a city of blow-ins or something, mm-hmm. but there must be a generation back, somebody who lived on the land.
Didn't the Behans move? Famously moved to Crumlin and hated it.
Brendan hated
Brendan
it,
blew up the bathroom.
The female members of the Behan family quite enjoyed it because it was a more civilized life out there than you might get in the tenements of the, and particularly if you were living with Brendan Behan.
And Roisin, you have actually been actively, I suppose, involved in perhaps making some predictions in terms of what you showed from 2006 and 2009. Not full-scale, maybe utopian conceptions, but I suppose some sort of predictions and possibilities of the future. Given that within such a short time frame, within those 3 years, you were dealing with such different circumstances and basing that work on such different presence, I suppose, is there almost any way to avoid, you know, the impact of the present when predicting the future, or how did you find that?
I think one of the differences between what we were doing in 2006 and 2009, that maybe earlier there was almost like a belief, just almost that the thing itself, the infrastructure or whatever, could sort the problem, or sort, you know, do stuff. Whereas the later ideas, I mean, some of them are very, very minor, but they were introducing a lot of other elements, like funding, thinking how people use things, ownership. I mean, it's kind of interesting, Ashby, that a lot of the other projects are all about the physical element itself, but it isn't about how people start to use it. But by introducing that other element, you know, city planning or city making isn't just about building cities, it's how people use it. And I think that for me that was one of the differences between the two, that the design element or the physical thing that we were making wasn't as significant, but we were actually, even in a very quick way, starting to think a lot more about how people use it and at those interactions, and the maybe less of a belief as well in planning, in, you know, because planning is very, by its nature, it's incredibly top down. And I think that's what you're saying, that Ireland never had that very strong top down belief. That there was always, people were almost distrustful in a way of it. And so, you know, that it's also, that there's something else that goes on. And maybe it's a bit more interesting when it's not just top down. So, you know, I think in 2006, we all kind of felt, oh God, if we could just get, you know, this planning to work and this central, you know, if things could just be done properly. But maybe that's never going to happen, and maybe what we have to find is a bit more, how can you use that natural maybe distrust to kind of make something? And I think one of the things I found a bit interesting after 2008 was that you kind of see in even just the street where I live, which is just over here on Essex Street, that there were some spaces that business that went out of business, and people took them over for different uses. There was an art center, but you could start to see things coming into being because of people just using the space. So there was kind of more of an interaction. That's not very coherent, but you know what I mean? It's kind of both working together rather than everything coming from above.
And is there anyone from the floor? Is there any particular questions? Speak now or forever, hold your peace. Yes, please.
It's kind of a question for everyone, but do you think it's as big a change as I think it is that it's so hard to get lost in the city? Like maybe we're kind of getting caught up in the present, but like anytime you go too far at sea now you have a smartphone and you know you can find exactly where you need to go, you can find exactly what transport you need to go, and to the point where you, like I recently got a smartphone and like you know you kind of feel like you're really backward if you're in a foreign city and you don't have a smartphone, you don't know Google Maps. And then I thought that was interesting when you're talking about the bus games and you didn't use a smartphone because you could have told you exactly what time you know, next bus and all that kind of stuff. And then to the point as well where Google Street View, like you can see your destination before you get, or you can walk your destination before you do that. Do you think that's like necessarily a bad thing that people are kind of, I would say they're using cities differently, but maybe they're not, but do you think that there's going to be kind of any consequences of that, do you think, in general, or is that impossible to answer?
No, I think people, especially with so much content, so much content online, Atlas Obscura is a site that documents, sort of historical site that documents interesting stuff, so they pop up in your Facebook timeline or whatever at some point in the future. But yeah, I mean, it's all about, it's not just about, I suppose the logic of something like Google Street View is starting to sort of pop up in all sorts of areas. So it's here's an interesting place and 600 words about it. Go here, go there. I mean, the fact is, I suppose the hope is, in a way, that there's so much stuff out there that even if it's documented, you still won't go to it. So at some point you might stumble upon it and not have your smartphone with you and go, oh, that's really interesting, I wonder what it is, and go home, and obviously then that's look it up on your computer or smartphone you've forgotten. But yeah, I mean, I still don't have a smartphone. But yeah, I think there's a real, is it bad? I don't know. I mean, I used Google Street View when I was writing this, so probably not. But yeah, I do think there's a sort of a, what would you call it? It's not really exploration, I suppose. You're following a path that you've already laid down. And in a way, that's what the bus game, much as I was frustrated, and many of the places I went to, I'd already been there or knew had passed by, I still didn't really know where I was going. You know what I mean, ultimately. And in cities, you know, it's still possible to get lost, I mean. But sometimes you just have to leave the technology at home. That's really, I mean, the situation has walked around cities carrying maps of other cities so that they would follow, they'd be in Paris, but they were following a London street map so that they were walking towards, you know, Big Ben, but actually they were, I don't know, somewhere. Wherever they were, you know, sort of Montmartre or something. But that kind of displacement, you have to actively seek it, I suppose. You can't, if you're sick of knowing where you are all the time, you have to go and get lost actively.
But I just wonder whether we will start to think about making urban space a bit differently, because, you know, this whole thing about, say, the icon or the church, it's so that you see it. So public buildings are very visible, but suddenly if you don't need to find anything because you always know where you're going, then everything can be anonymous. So I wonder, will there be a change in how we start to think? Because even if you think about advertising, you know, think about Hong Kong and all those bright lights, you know, it was always like the biggest, the loudest, but now you don't need to do that. So maybe we will start to think about things differently. It's an interesting question.
I guess those buildings are also extortion of power, which hasn't really changed. I mean, the church isn't really there to be seen, it's just started. And you know, to it as a landmark to find your way, as opposed to a certain
Yeah, no, you're right, there is that as well. Yeah. But I mean, maybe. But. Yeah, I suppose it's what's the assertion of power now? Is it always in physical size? But you know, when you think about cities, you're a lot of the time you are trying to, okay, the church is an assertion of power, but you are, cities are kind of constructed on these landmarks and things are kind of, there's fabric and landmark, you know, it's kind of very generic kind of way of describing the city. And you know, if you think about shop fronts, you know, it's always you try to make it visible because so that you'll see it. But if there isn't that need to catch your visual attention anymore, I do think that you might start to think about things differently. Mm-hmm. But it's so recent, you know, it's hard to...
Google, for instance, now are being seen as, I think it's geocaching or something, I can't remember the exact name, or at the shop window, will actually, I suppose, pick up your phone. There's a lack at the moment in signal, basically, I suppose, and in connectivity between the physical and online. Where we're being mostly, we're mostly doing most of our shopping, predominantly, say, commercial. But interesting enough, Google are now kind of picking up on that. And say if you walked in, say somebody like London shopping centre, where signal might not so good, there'd be a beacon, I think we should call it a beacon, which would sell to you directly, let's say, would pick up kind of what's being collected by cookies on your phone and put the ad in front of you in a real context, like say on an LED screen in the shop or in the route to the shop. That's what these are, where shop windows might change in a better world.
Any comments or questions?
I like the idea of buildings of kind of outsourcing their memorability. Like, they can be as anonymous as they want now because you're always going to know what they are.
Yeah.
Unless your phone runs out of battery and then you're confronted
with... Or you lose your Wi-Fi signal.
Yeah, that's it. So a bunch of people scratching their heads looking stressed in the street.
That's what I always find that in London because there's such an intense, you know, because of the population, that a lot of times it's so hard to get a signal. So there's funny that kind of suddenly the inverse happens. You're just kind of like, oh, where do I go now?
Google says so, therefore it's real.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, with the idea of these roads, you know, these sort of sat-nav roads that don't actually exist and bring you to a lake or something. So you can start to play with where things are.
Yeah.
Potential.
Oh, yeah, if you want.
I had a question about utilizing the empty lots for gardens and for the country culture. Is it happening, or is it or were you talking about it more?
For ours was just a suggestion. It did happen in Pittsburgh and in Philadelphia, because some of those American cities, say Pittsburgh, Cleveland, you know, they're those very industrialized cities that then got emptied out, and the downtown was very, very empty. So they had a program of greening these empty lots. So I think sometimes neighbors could take it over, or maybe it hasn't needed it.
Not in the
large
scale.
Not in those
significant
scales.
There's one on South Circle Road.
Yeah. I don't think it happened.
Yeah.
So less of the community gardens than people have gardens in there.
There's an apartment block near Inchicore where a friend of mine kind of went to the property managers or whatever and kind of ended up, there was a bank at the back that runs along the railway line. They ended up being able to use that as a community garden. So I think it's happened. No, it hasn't been concerted, but there was a bit of a kind of grassroots effort.
Actually, on Mercer House there, that I've shown, like they have a small little, they had a patch of ground between the footpath and the block of flats, and they gardened that and grew things on. So on a small scale, but not at that scale.
Yeah.
I don't think.
Because green space costs a lot of money, so if you have people take ownership, because that's always the issue that comes up with these kind of communities, a space that developers don't want to have to manage it, or the city can maintain it. So if you have the community look after it, you have some of the benefit, but you don't have the maintenance costs. So it kind of works well, but it's kind of a more, that's a kind of a local.
Thank you.
from Toronto, and it's kind of like a becoming a trend, kind of having other people converting the lawns from just places like grass to growing food and shit, and the whole idea of very local serving food.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And also like the door-to-door delivery kind of gardens.
Great. Well, I might wrap it up there if that's okay. I'm just really hungry, to be honest. I want to get some dinner now. But before I let you all go, there's a few bits and bobs I'd like to mention. A few words of thanks as well. Thanks to Carol's Bakery for all the cupcakes. If you haven't grabbed them, I think there might be some on the way out. I'll be eating them if you don't take them, so save me from myself, please. Many thanks to the Project Arts Centre as well for hosting us this evening. They've been awesome, and it's not too late. The fire exits are over there. I forgot that at the beginning, but anyway. And I think the main thing then to mention is really just that our final talk, our third and final talk in the Standard Lives series will be taking place on the 18th of November, Wednesday 18th of November at 7 p.m. in the Chocolate Factory. So hopefully you'll be able to join us for that session also. It'll be titled This Space Without Time, and it's really all about change and our perceptions of change and our prejudices and how change comes about. And for that, we'll have film director Donald Foreman, DCC planner Kieran Rose, writer Kevin Bratnock, and architect and lecturer Fintan Duffy. So we'll have more information up about that soon on the usual Facebook channels and Twitter at Tuha Magazine, place probably find us and all that kind of jazz. And so the last thing just to say is many thanks for coming, and many, many thanks to our speakers, Brian, Roisin and Carl.